need backup. Don't forget about that.
Tonight's meeting of the Conservation Commission is being recorded for RCTV. It's live, Comcast Channel 22 and Verizon Channel 33. And check www.rctv.org for more information and for replay times. So we have about 5 minutes before we start. Good evening.
Good evening, everyone.
Mr. Flynn?
We don't have any.
Do we have any old business that we could get through?
You could do a certificate of compliance for
181 South Street.
181 South Street.
Okay. Did you guys went to the site visit? And how are things? I didn't make it on Sunday.
It's the work is complete. Everything looks solid and stable. There's no, the grass has grown in. The driveway looks, you know, everything's well constructed. And,
mm-hmm.
It's just a little, the driveway is a little bigger than the original plan called for by, I think, 8 square feet. But it's not the sort of thing you'd go change, so a tiny change, fine. Nice.
That 8 feet, wasn't that part of the minor project change too? Or was that?
I believe I don't care.
I understand that there's a small portion in the 100-foot inner riparian zone, and then the rest of it was on the 200.
Correct.
Do I hear a motion to issue a certificate of compliance?
Make a motion to issue the certificate of compliance for.
Sure, Chuck's going to capture it.
181.
Oh.
Oh, this is.
Don't worry about it.
I'm going to interrupt for a second. I'm sorry. Chuck will be taking meeting minute notes, and I was hoping that Anika might be able to serve as a backup for this meeting.
I will do what I can. I think at this point we're also relying pretty heavily on the video, thanks to RCTV for tonight, because hopefully the meeting will be succinct and it won't be an agonizing refresh to double check the minutes. So, but yeah, I will be backup, but we have not discussed what role, you know, exactly what minutes, like, am I going to record the vote? Is he going to record detail? You know, that sort of thing. That was not discussed until just now. Brought up, so.
I think we want to capture everything as best we can. I mean, I can note down.
You've
votes
taken
as well.
Notes before. If you can just do whatever the similar to that was, how it worked out between what I did and what you did. So anyways, there was a vote, and who
Mike made a motion.
Make a motion to issue the certificate of compliance for 181 South Street.
And Harry seconded.
Second. All those in favor? Okay.
So that was a universal pause.
Then you can do that very next one, which is bond release for 270-0646.
1261 Main Street, Ahern. It's not on the agenda. And that was the site where they removed a metal pipe. We're looking to release the bond. Do I hear a motion to release the bond?
So moved.
Yep. If you want a little background, we reissued their certificate of compliance at the last meeting. They've recorded that at the Registry of Deeds and provided me a copy of it, and the next step is to release the bond.
Do I hear a second?
I'll second.
All those in favor? All those abstain. Dave?
Who made the motion?
I did.
Anika.
And Harry seconded.
That's not on our.
No, it's not on the agenda.
And that was 270-0646.
270-0646.
Okay. Roger that.
Okay. It's 7:05, and we can talk about the first item on the agenda, which is a request for determination of applicability for 2016-13194 Van Norden Road, map 38, lot 200, and Selvak Kumar. And Mr. Selvak Kumar is here.
Hi.
Let's do a site visit.
We, yeah, so Dave and I, Chuck went.
Right.
And it's on a completely flat surface on existing lawn without removing any trees. You're gonna leave the same grade, put a little pea stone under it. 8x12?
Yeah.
Out of the 35, right, so. Looks like it's out of the 35.
It's out of the 35, it's behind the house, so there's not a lot of wiggle room of places to put it, but anything else you would add? Pretty, very straightforward.
And there are no, you said that there would be no stairs.
No.
No stairs.
And there's no grading. No grading is gonna.
Well, he's just gonna do the leveling for, with the four corners stones or whatever.
All right.
My understanding is that the four corners would be placed on concrete cinder blocks, or concrete blocks.
So no real foundations, no.
Right.
Does the shed come in pre-made?
Yeah, so I think they are somewhere on site, they just put it together.
So the walls would be pre-made and then you put it together?
Okay, I have no objections.
Do any of the members of the commission have any questions? Anyone from the public have any questions? Hearing none.
Make a motion for a negative determination for RDA 2016-13194 Van Norden.
I'll second.
All those in favor? Okay.
So you're all set?
Great. Thank you.
Thanks for coming in.
Thank you.
Is that a unanimous?
Yes.
Yes.
6-0.
Yep.
You voted, right, Dave?
Yes, I did.
Yes, David did.
Great.
It's not quite 7:10. And I guess we have a continued certificate of compliance for 270-0625 Mariano Drive, 92 Sambling Lane, Lot 3. Correct. Mr. Coulier?
Yes.
And Chuck, on 270-0582, 244 R Ash Street, are they still there?
I called the owners twice and never received a reply back. And what I was told when they came in for their occupancy is that the grass was just planted and they were waiting for it to grow. And a couple weeks ago, I heard that it just got burnt by the sun. So we're still in limbo.
Okay. All right.
So continue?
Yeah.
Let's continue. Another minute.
Austin. Austin Prep.
Right. Wetland Rep. Okay. Chuck, on Austin Prep, did they remove all, do you know if they've removed all of the hay bales?
I received an email from Dr. Hickey this week. And he asked if he wanted verification on the fact that the commission needs a second letter to evaluate the winter kill of the wetland replication area. And I provided that to him, and I also told him that the commission had been out there and, you know, at this spring of next year would like to see another letter just because of their site visit alone.
And then I reiterated
the fact that we wanted the entire hay to be removed.
Right. Did they also purchase more replacement vegetation? Weren't they going to do that?
So they were
going to
buy some more trees,
right,
to replace the ones that died. There was a couple of
situations. Just right now is a really terrible time to try to put them in and grow. So hopefully they'll do that in the fall.
sorry, was, did that, was there a site visit last time?
No.
There was a site visit.
It was a couple times ago.
Change, yeah, okay.
Yeah.
A while ago.
Yep.
I recall.
We've just been discussing it.
Yeah, I don't recall the additional vegetation, but I remember the hay bales, so we've been saying that for a while now.
Well, I think they, said something to the effect that they were going to, there were some dead trees, saplings, and that they were going to, replace those.
Okay.
That would have been in the last status report they sent us, do you remember that?
Okay, this is, 7/10, and we have a notice of intent for 270-, do we have a number, Jack?
No, we don't have a number.
Okay. Yeah, 76 Longwood Road.
I didn't check just now, but I did check around 4. No, yeah, it's not there.
Okay. For map 19, lot 15, Mahoney property, and this is a public hearing for notice of intent 270 unknown number at this point. DEP hasn't issued. Is now opened and being conducted concurrently under the authority of the Massachusetts Wetlands Protection Act, Massachusetts General Laws, Chapter 131, Section 3040, as amended, and the General Reading Bylaw, Section 7.1. Applicant will be conducted in the following manner. Applicant or representative will present the proposal. Commission will receive reports from the administrator, technical advisors, and or other town departments. The commission will address questions and comments to the applicant, and the public will be given the opportunity to ask questions of the applicant, and which should be directed to the chair. And when you do, please give your name and address before your comments. Did everybody sign in? Is there an attendance sheet back there?
I had it passed along. Did you guys get that attendance sheet?
At this time, would members of the Conservation Commission please introduce themselves, on starting on the left?
Chuck Tironi, Conservation Administrator.
Michael Flynn.
Anika Scanlon, Vice Chair.
Rebecca Longley, Chair.
Harry Curtis.
Al Couliard.
David Pinnett.
Great. For the record, my name's Jack Sullivan. I'm the engineer for the project. I'm here with the homeowner of the board, Laura Mahoney. And we're basically in front of you tonight. They'd like to do a small addition to their existing single-family home. What's interesting with this site is the entire site's within the riverfront area. The house was constructed in 1970, so it predates 1959. The house was constructed in 1959. There was a lot change in 1970, a lot line change. But both the age of the home and that lot adjustment was made prior to the 1996 Riverfront Act going into effect. So what was interesting with this site is we had to get a little bit creative. Basically, as you know, within 100 feet of the river, you're not supposed to get any closer to the riverbank. And there's thresholds on the amount of disturbance and other things that factor in. But what's interesting, under minor projects, you're allowed to construct a roof porch if it's under 100 square feet, if you're outside of 50 feet, as a minor project, and also a deck if it's over a previously disturbed area or grassed area, as long as you're 50 feet away. That's a minor project as well. So two of the items I show on the plan, I reference that. We show a 99 square foot roof porch. So even though I'm getting closer to the bank, I'm still outside of 50 feet to both the riverbank and the BBW on site. The proposed deck is in the area where there's basically an existing deck. The deck is over 50 feet from the wetlands, and the deck would be constructed, there'd be crushed stone beneath it. So it's an open slotted deck. It would allow rainwater to move through it and go back into the ground. So really, this notice of intent, even though those two other items are shown, really come down to the proposed one-story addition. So they're proposing an eight-foot, four-inch by 20-foot long proposed one-story addition off the rear of the house. What's important to note is the existing back left-hand corner of the house is 73 feet from the bank. The proposed addition at the closest point to the bank is 77 feet. As you can see on the plan, on the screen here, right now in the area where the proposed porch is going to go, there's a concrete patio that will be removed, and here's the area of the existing deck. So the majority of this work is going over areas where there's existing structures, and all the work is going over an area that's previously disturbed. What you'll see is I actually had to do something on the deck here. I had to angle the deck. I'd rather come straight out and over. If I do that, then I wouldn't necessarily qualify for the minor project. But when we have a notice of intent in front of you, I wanted to talk to you about it. We could just permit that through this notice of intent project. But to try to move this forward, I originally showed it that one, then I wanted to discuss it with you what your thoughts are if you did square up that deck. I did have Norris Environmental flag the wetlands. All the work is outside 35 foot no structure zone. What the owner would like to do is, I'm showing the proposed steps coming off this way, off the porch. If we are allowed to square up the deck, we would like to put the steps over on this side of the deck, which would be closer to the wetland, but it would still be outside the 35 foot no structure zone. I tried to show where the construction access would be. It would have to be on this side of the house, and I extended the erosion control the full length of the construction route. They wouldn't be able to use the existing driveway. There's a small timber retaining wall here. There's about a 2 foot grade distance, so it would be difficult to get construction vehicles in and out on this side. So they'll have to use this side. And there's really no grading changes associated. The porch will be constructed on sonotubes. The decking will have sonotubes. The one-story addition will have a full foundation, but any material excavated for that, it'll basically be a walkout basement in the back. Material just be loaded right into a truck every move, so I didn't show a soil stockpile area. I should note that this is an existing two-car garage. It's one story. They're proposing to rip that down to the foundation, but to reutilize the existing foundation and frame back a two-story structure, but no footprint change to that area. So that's basically it in a nutshell. Like we say, with the riverfront standards, you know, there is a threshold we have to overcome. That's why I tried to do this as basically two minor projects and then a small addition, and with the idea that we'd be further from the bank than the existing house.
Oh, Jack, how many sonotubes?
It's only a 10-foot span on this here, so there'd probably be two, three, four. There'd be four on the porch. And then on the deck, if we're allowed to square it up over a 20-foot run, there'd probably be four, total of six on the deck, if we can square it up. Probably six sonotubes on the deck. We don't have finished plans yet. Laura's been working with an architect, but we wanted to make sure, you know, the commission was on board with this before she went too far with the final design of her plans.
You folks went out on the site, but I also went out on Sunday and I took a look at the flags in back on the bank. And my observation, I can always see Steve Erickson's blue flags with, I like that he does the metal, yeah, because they don't get ripped off or lost. It seemed to me that they were about 1 or 2 feet down from the top of the slope, so I don't know how he established the annual mean high water. And I also, I walked all the way to the east, I think, if I've got that right, along the back, and there is an isolated, it looks like what to me was an isolated wetland area. Is it connected, do you know?
I do not know. And when he originally flagged this, he was under the impression the Abajona River was intermittent, which it's not. But
I don't think it makes
a difference,
whole lot
yeah.
difference of what he flagged. I couldn't find the flags.
This is the beeline.
Right, the be- did you guys see the beet flags?
No, it's
anybody see?
On the plan, it looks like it's there, but it, we couldn't find,
I couldn't find them.
Find the flags.
So I, probably the next door neighbor ripped them off.
That's what I'm thinking.
The only thing, you kind of get an idea of where they should have been based on the plan and based on the location.
Right.
You know,
it's definitely wet, but it looked to me to be isolated. I didn't see any connection on that far eastern side.
To the Arizona?
Yeah.
Yeah, I didn't, you know,
how far did you go out
into
that area?
I don't think we went out
how
that
far.
How
far did I go?
So wait, so east is this way.
I mean, it looked fairly wet for a while
west.
There. Because it had a
southwest.
Lot of children. Spread
impatience.
Out. Yeah.
Yeah.
Spread out all the way through the back of that guy's lawn, but there were no flags up there.
No.
So one thing I did notice is that it looked, you know, so you go out there, you kind of anticipate where the 3B is. It looked like, you know, it was probably based on the fence about in the right location. It didn't, you know, again, we didn't see the flags. It didn't quite look like 4B was in the right location. You know, it looked like it probably would have been closer along the fence line.
And I also don't know. I didn't know if that was connected, and I don't know if it was in 500 square feet.
500 square feet.
Know.
I don't. Yeah.
So it's. But I don't think it makes much difference to this plan.
Can I ask a general question about the back? So the backyard within the stockade fence. That's all lawn.
Yes.
Correct.
Except for that little existing play structure.
Sure.
Now that's a little wooden structure, and it's lined with wood, and then there's black paper underneath, and then there's chips on top.
Yeah.
And then there's a structure on top of that.
Right.
And I talked to your husband about that, and they were willing, now that the boys are older, that they could take that out and, you know, remove the black paper, which would take out the imperviousness of that area, and you know, you'd be adding probably more grass, but
still impervious.
Right.
You know, in my experience, at some point, those things all go away. You know,
yeah.
The kids grow up, and you want the lawn back. So whether you ask to have it taken away or not, it's going at some point.
So I looked at it a little differently. Because with it all being within the 100-foot inner riparian zone, going back to the performance standards for riverfront, the work shall meet the performance standards for all other resource areas within the riverfront areas identified in coastal banks, salt marsh, and bordering vegetated wetland, and land subject to flooding. So when work in the riverfront area is also within the buffer zone to another resource area, the performance standards for the riverfront shall contribute to the protection of the interests of the Act in lieu of any additional requirements. So I read that as to say we can ignore the wetland flags, it's within 100 feet, and just use that as the standard. Is that, you guys agree with that interpretation?
I think, I mean, that's the state standard.
Right.
Okay, in this situation, we have a lot of overlapping jurisdictional areas.
I didn't
areas,
see anything in the
And the 25 and the 35 setback are more of a town bylaw standard. So it's, in my opinion, it's kind of
it's
a both and.
It's got to be both.
We have to apply both the state and the local bylaw.
Okay.
I mean, I don't have any objection to squaring off the proposed deck. I don't know how other people on the commission feel about that.
So what I'll say about the 4B, although I didn't think it was potentially in the right location, it was still, you know, it wasn't going to move enough, from what I could tell, if you follow kind of follow that line, that it was going, then the structure was still going to be outside the 35-foot, easily outside the 35-foot zone.
I see what you're saying. Yep.
Just as far as, you know, when we talk about squaring off and getting
right,
a little bit closer.
Can I just ask a question? So on the plan it says proposed 1 ST addition and then there's the portion of the deck that has the X through it. Are those the two polygons that are gonna have additional roof?
Correct.
Okay.
So with this X is that that's the roof porch, that's gonna be this summer.
Okay.
Right, yeah. And then the approach addition will have a roof as well.
Jack, what I didn't understand was the increase in impervious. Did you write something about that?
I did not, because the way I looked at this is the roof porch is basically an exempt minor activity. And then if you look at the addition, we're adding about 160 square feet, but they're removing about the equal amount of the concrete patio in the rear, so it's almost a net increase of zero for impervious.
I apologize, I'm looking at proposed alteration in the riverfront area, that's what was sticking in my head. Never mind, thank you.
There also is one other thing too, underneath where the proposed addition, there's some brick pavers there that are gonna be removed as well.
Correct.
Do you have a proposed distance, if you did square the deck off, what the dimension would be?
Well, it would be 20 by 10 on both sides, right?
Right, 20 by 10, yep.
And also you propose, and if you did move the stairs over to that side, that they actually would only go towards the direction of the backyard, they wouldn't be off the outer edge of the deck.
She would like them off the outer edge, but she said she, correct me if I'm wrong, but she could also put the stairs over here, the steps over here,
mm-hmm.
off the addition.
I was just saying that you wouldn't be going off the south side of the deck, that linear side, right?
Over here?
Right, and going.
No.
So the deck would have no stairs and you'd enter the addition to go down the stairs, enter and exit the addition?
I think the addition.
I think they're talking about the stairs right here.
No, well, he just said that the
it would be
you could, should put them in here.
Under the deck.
So then the stairs
deck.
Can
yes.
be up here.
But onto the deck.
No.
Is there going to be, a door off the end of the addition? So you're going to walk out, is there going to be a door out to the deck and a door out to a set of stairs on that end? Or
it
is
yeah.
it just.
It would be under the screened porch.
Oh,
right.
The doorway would be there.
So no doors out of the proposed
no.
addition?
So Jack, where are the stairs going? The proposed, if
I
we squared off the deck, where are they proposing
like to
the
put
stairs?
Them in here, right, Laura?
So the platform for the stairs would be an additional 42 inches from the 20 feet.
Correct. And I think off the top of my head, when I squared this off, I think I was at like 46 feet from the if the deck was squared to the wetland line, we'd still be well outside.
If the deck was squared with the platform.
With the platform, we'd still probably be 40 feet from the wetlands. I can give an exact distance.
If you take that 4B, though, and put it back closer to the property line, where are you then?
Yeah, so that I was just
that's a question.
Gonna add, you know, in lieu of moving, you know, squaring it off, moving 4B, and then adding steps, we're all of a sudden talking about how close are we. You know, it's difficult to tell. Without, you know, again, we don't have
seen
necessarily the
plan.
Exactly.
We're moving a lot of flags 2 and 3 feet the last couple of meetings. I don't know, is that a good habit to get into?
This might have been more than 2 or 3 feet.
You think
yeah,
it's more
if
than
you,
I didn't go on the site visit,
yeah.
so I didn't look at it.
If that goes adjacent to the property line, that's more than a few feet.
That's 15 feet or 18
yeah.
feet if you're going to put it on the property line.
It's not the property line.
Closer to
10 feet. Well, it's kind of hard to speculate without having some concrete dots on a plan.
So
just sort of thinking a little bit about stairs to the southwest of the proposed deck. I mean, could the stairs do a little landing and then turn?
Mm-hmm.
you know, towards the river. You know, and just do a little, instead of coming straight out towards the,
I'm thinking that they are closer to the proposed addition. If they were on that particular side, you might be further away from that 4B, if that's the issue.
Where would it be? I don't understand. I don't follow.
This is the proposed addition. Instead of having the stairs out here, having them more here.
Right, but
then
what I'm saying is instead of pointing the stairs towards the neighbor, have a little landing and then point the stairs.
Yeah, I know.
Yeah.
So I still haven't got, so this proposed addition is a covered roof, a screened porch, is that what it is?
Screened porch.
It's a screened porch. So is there an objection to not having the stairs on the deck, but having them on the screened porch? So you could have them closer to the house and then have them go down to the backyard.
Where they're shown?
No, they're not shown on here. So I'm talking about like where the 8.4 is, Jack, on that plan. We put this, a platform, the 42-inch platform there, and then ran the stairs down. Is there an objection to
that's
that?
Not a screened porch. That's an
addition.
Yeah, that's an addition. That's what I'm
that's
saying.
Not a, that's not a screened porch.
Screened porch?
Yeah.
Oh, this deck is going to be screened in too?
No.
No.
No, the proposed deck is open. The proposed first addition is just solid building.
Yeah.
Solid
it's
building.
Just
is how
extension
I understand
of
it.
The screened porch is
and
the is the square
so
with the X.
So what's in the addition? What is that space going to be?
House.
Expanded kitchen.
Expanded kitchen. So you can't have a door onto a deck there. Okay.
Can I ask if there's no door going out of the proposed single-story addition there? That what would, I guess other than you.
No, there.
If you're coming out.
From the kitchen onto the deck, there will be a door.
Oh, there is? Oh,
yes.
I misunderstood you. I thought there was not. I thought there was only one coming out onto the screen porch.
No, that would be from the deck.
Oh, so there's
so
no
you have a door from
the house proper
the to the deck, and then you open the door to the screen porch.
So just from my own I know I would be comfortable if it was were squared off. I would be fine with that. What I would hesitate is moving the steps. I think I like the idea of the steps being further away from the wetland. I think between not quite knowing where that 35-foot line is and already moving somewhat closer, I'm under the opinion that having it on that east side is probably still the better plan for staying away from the no structure zone.
Can I propose something else that just piggybacks with what you're saying? I really don't have a problem with squaring off the deck, but perhaps, I don't know if, Anika, this is what you were getting at on the southwest side of the deck there. If you actually came off of where it says the 2.2, and put a landing that came out there and then actually shot back towards the house and put another landing there and then come back around and then go back down that way. So then you're staying further away from that 35 and 50 foot line, and the stairs would not be a player at all at that point.
I think you're talking about another four or how many more footings for that, Jack, to have three separate platforms.
Yeah, that's a lot.
That's a lot of platforms and
that's a lot of
turning.
What about?
But it would keep it further away.
What about if
maybe
you put the stairs like straight out like this, and I don't really want to be designing, but right at the porch and right at the deck. I mean, you're going closer, but I don't see a difference between that and that.
Maybe the applicant wants the opportunity for the board to go out with Steve and defend that 4B flag. And if that doesn't move, then we'd be fine with the running the stairs off the corner.
Well, honestly, I don't, I think the, I'd
you
like
have an idea?
To
I think we have a solution, and I'll show it up here. So,
okay.
We're thinking of taking these steps, put them right here, up to a platform here so she can access onto the
deck. You can write on that if you want.
Okay.
I have no
yeah.
problem with that.
The,
yeah.
green, the green one doesn't work.
I would have
the
no problem
do.
With that. That's away
I
from,
mean,
that's away from
right.
no,
the green
doesn't what
work.
I was going to sort of say is, you know, it seems like the constraint is the 35-foot no build.
Mm-hmm.
And so you know, I don't wanna dictate where you wanna put your stairs. But it, you know, for, to comply with that no build, it'd be good if the stairs were out of it.
Right.
I agree.
So, I mean, that would be the only condition I would put on that.
If we just put the steps coming up right here, this with my up arrow, here's the number of steps, there'd be a platform here. What Laura's concern was, which I agree with her, she feels the screen porch being basically 10 by 10 is pretty small, and then you have a door opening up into that area. You don't want to open out onto the stairs, it would have to open in. She'd end up losing a lot of space, which is a good point.
And for flowing in people.
And for flow, so this way, if we're allowed to square it up, then we won't even deal with being close if that 4B did move in. But we could have the steps come up, she could have a platform off this deck, and she still utilizes all the space within the porch.
When you enter your backyard, do you go in from the right or the left, usually? Both, so there isn't a strong preference one way or the other.
No, I think that works right there.
How does everybody else feel about that?
I'm, given the current layout of the wetland, I'm comfortable with that.
Okay, rather than going back out and messing with putting more flags out and putting, figure out where 4B is, I think this is a solution. Are there any questions from the applicant or the administrator?
So, you know, Jack, I know that it qualifies as a minor project permit, but I, when I fill out the form, say this, they agree to this, I need the existing impervious and the proposed.
Okay.
So you have to give me that.
Okay.
And the one question on that topic that I had was,
and with the new, you know, corner of the deck too.
It's probably what, 50 feet of incremental impervious where the porch is taking up the space of the concrete patio underneath it, but the other, was it 8 by 20? 8.4 by 20 is gonna be 400-something square feet. So some, to Chuck's point, is, you know, your net add of somewhere in the neighborhood of 500 square feet, right? Of impervious?
Yeah, and we're removing a concrete patio, but I would say our net increase is probably like 200, 250 total. Because you have right here, this section here.
Yeah.
That's where the concrete patio is. There's a brick patio over here. But if you take into account basically 100 square feet for the porch and then another 160 for the addition, that's 260.
I'm sorry, I was doing the math wrong. You're right. Yeah.
Right.
Okay. All right.
And then you take out. So, I mean, there may be a net increase of like 100 square
yeah.
feet.
Yeah. Okay. I'm sorry.
I think that's conservative too. I mean,
that's conservative. Yeah.
So, Chuck, we need some more information.
Are we gonna?
We don't have a file number yet.
Okay.
Need a little bit more information. And I was just gonna follow that up with: is there any? Since it's mostly in the riverfront, is there 100 square feet of impervious around there that we can find to offset this increase?
Why can't you rip up the
existing play structure?
Yeah, that's way structure. I thought we were going to include that structure being
Why
removed.
Can't you rip up the
playground?
Black paper. That's impervious.
If it's impervious, how does that?
Sorry.
It's much larger. The play structure area is much larger than 100 square
yeah.
feet.
Yeah. If it's impervious, how does that drain?
It just
sheet flows off.
Down to.
Is it landscape fabric or is it black plastic?
It's black plastic.
No, it's just the weed thing. So it's the landscape fabric.
So that's pervious material to begin with.
Yeah.
I thought it was black plastic.
No, we put it down ourselves.
You know, in the past, I'm not sure if. If this, what did you say, Chuck? You said you didn't
About
use the word mitigation, did you?
No.
You tried not to.
You tried not to.
I didn't say mitigation.
I have a question. Here's another question then. So I think to your point, the property, the left over the garage, you're changing the roof line, right?
Yes.
you're going up.
Yeah.
And is there any Coltech or anything there receiving the rainwater from the gutters today? Anything?
No.
To introduce it into the ground? Is there a plan to do that?
It's not.
Because I know it's not, you're not changing the impervious area. I was just thinking if there was already something there that you could channel the water from the addition into. It would get you to the same place, right? Is that what you're thinking?
Well, it's, we have seen some of your projects, you know, do roof runoff infiltration.
Correct.
Not certain, would that be required in this situation? I think we need to see the impervious numbers.
Yeah, I think the net increase in the impervious is like 100 square feet, which is pretty minimal. So Chuck, what are you asking for in this riverfront area? I'm not quite understanding it.
My question had to do with just filling out the form with the order of conditions. I needed existing impervious and then proposed. But
I thought you were asking for something.
No, with the riverfront, infiltration is part of it, but not usually with just BBW. So, I don't know. And lately, on most of our projects, we've been asking for any new roofs, they're infiltrated somehow.
And there have been a variety of ways we've...
Yeah, and there's been a variety of ways, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I don't think it has to be like a Caltech, but I mean, it could be a drip trench.
Right.
Yeah,
I mean,
I was
it could be
say.
Something that's workable, not expensive, but works.
Yeah. We could either do a drip trench, or I had talked to Laura before the meeting, and saying if we had to put in like a 500-gallon dry well and pipe the proposed addition and maybe even the roof area, the porch, if they can take those two areas, then I can show a net effective increase of zero or less.
Let me
be a positive.
Just as a question, isn't this property all basically down slope of the road?
Yes.
Yes.
So whatever rain falls on any portion of this property is going to not flow towards the road as road runoff. It's going to go
towards the Abergona.
Towards the Abergona, you know, whether it's infiltrated quickly or whether it finds its own way. So. I don't think the topography of the property is such that we have to be concerned about capturing that water with a Coltech or a dry well. I think it definitely would be helpful to make sure there is infiltration. But I don't think we need, you know, really state of the art infiltration in this project.
Right, that's what I'm saying. Just something basic.
I agree.
Okay.
So I think do you have enough information?
I think we're all in agreement of the change, squaring off the deck and new location of the stairs with the platform and perhaps some kind of drip trench for infiltration of the proposed addition and perhaps the porch runoff, roof runoff. And
if you want to throw on the playground, you can.
I don't, you know what, it doesn't matter.
Yeah.
Take it out or leave it. It's pervious material, then just, it doesn't matter. You probably take it out later on. But we're not, it's not part of what we are looking for. So we don't have enough to close. Do we have enough to approve?
We don't close anyways.
I don't have the DEP file.
No, we wouldn't close, but we could approve. We have done that in the past, but...
Yeah.
I said, I move we continue.
I second.
Okay.
I second.
All those in favor of continuing?
Thank you.
Thanks, Jack. When is the next meeting?
In 2 weeks.
2 weeks.
On a Wednesday.
Okay.
I don't know.
Thanks, Jack.
I made the motion.
And
I made the motion.
I seconded.
Mike seconded.
5-0.
6-0.
Thanks for coming in.
Well, I've been
Enjoy
counting wrong this whole time.
Afternoon. What?
I've been counting wrong this whole time. Yeah, I didn't really.
Have an enforcement order for 218 Salem Street, map 23, lot 90. Mr. Yonjin.
Hello.
Hi.
Hi.
Good evening.
Thank you.
Sure.
We're gonna share that. Green light one. Chuck, you get. Oh, Chuck's getting on the board.
This is so. This is from the when the house was built from 1999.
That's
not a permit.
And that's existing.
This.
No, I didn't get
no
to
this
see
is
this.
That's from the.
That's the same plan, I
conditions.
Believe.
Chuck.
Right. That's
is
from
that the
same
plan that Becky has right there?
Yes, it is.
Okay.
Yeah, we have that plan too. If you wanted to
talk
about that one.
Copies by everyone, so just in case if they want it.
Yeah, once you. Yeah, they. I don't think they have. So we worked up this plan in the office, to in which he's passing out now, which I have on the board.
Thank you.
Which kind of highlights where things are.
Yeah, don't give me that one.
Oh, really?
No, I was going to say, don't give me the one you wrote your special
okay.
stuff on. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Okay.
I'll take one, yeah.
Okay. So I just have, okay, we have that one too. Okay.
Yeah. And again, you can draw on that board if you want to put in what you have on this.
Thank you.
Okay, so, all right. What is the blue hatching?
That was my second one. That was just forget about that for now. There's nothing in. The green ones that I have is where the that's the conservation line.
The
wetland. And the orange one is the conservation restriction line.
Gotcha.
And the other one just added that one.
So I have a first question, which is probably for one of the people on the commission that's smarter than me, which is everybody. I looked on the current FEMA flood map, and it looked like this was no longer in the 100-year floodplain. So I thought it would be good to start by just making sure we have our facts straight about where actually the floodplain is. Because I see the 100-year, okay, so this wasn't on the one I was looking at yesterday, this 100-year. I saw the previous. So can.
It's the same though. It's 190.25 feet elevation.
So if we can just get this.
Oh, I see why.
So we're talking about, you know where we are, right? You
mm-hmm.
see where that yellow lot.
It's not working because it would be somewhere in that swamp for sure.
So what I saw, I went to the FEMA website, and maybe that wasn't the right place to go, but that showed a.
Are those stairs included in this?
No.
No, that's.
Stop. Oh yeah, those really big stairs.
stairs down to the swamp.
I'll zoom back in.
So.
So that's the 100-year floodplain?
That's how it showed, well, that's the wetland layer that, that's on there, and that, see what's going on here. That's what you're looking at with a flyover.
There's the inaccuracy, but.
But.
I was gonna, don't we tell applicants not to pay attention to this?
Well, this was done, I mean, there was a delineation when this was put together in 99.
Yes.
Yeah.
99.
Right.
Yeah, it really doesn't seem to be exactly.
I'm lost, I don't know what, what's the violation, what are we doing?
Okay, well, we need to, just wait a second.
All right, I'll wait.
Did you read your emails?
I.
The violation was sent to you in your email.
Yeah, I didn't read it.
Okay.
I'm gonna read it now.
I can tell you.
Aaron's gonna give you the abbreviated version.
It also happens to be on this enforcement order as well, so.
Let's go on.
So.
No certificate of compliance here?
No, so,
Okay, so who went on a site visit to?
I went on Sunday, and Mike, Carrie, Dave went Tuesday, and Chuck, Tuesday night.
And Chuck, last night. So essentially, these bounds are essentially.
You were the only one, didn't you, Nika?
Yeah.
Al.
It's all wetland, no, they're still there.
Oh, and Al didn't know.
Basically rubbed everything inside of this.
You would know what the enfor, what the,
So is the area of clearing trees and filling and grading, is that the area in the blue?
No, this is something afterwards, so we're gonna have this discussion after the, afterwards, I think.
That's. Okay.
I don't wanna presume for him, but I can, I think.
Can you just have it, since I wasn't on the site visit, can you give me a sense of where relative to the house, the enforcement activities happened?
I get it.
Yeah, so we performed a site visit, I'm gonna go up to plan, Al, we'll summarize up here. So we went out to the site, there, prior to, we understand, prior to the existing site, you have the driveway located here, the existing home, and a retaining wall located along this line here. Currently, what's out there is, there was a proposed new retaining wall, a retaining wall that was being built.
One second.
Should we have the other line, the orange?
This one?
Yes.
So it's.
I get it, in a second.
Right.
Yeah. New retaining wall being built along this blue line here.
Okay.
So the, it looked like there was, you know, this wall was taken apart, looked like some filling was occurring in this area. Trees were being cut and some filling was occurring in this area as well.
I also think that there was cutting of the land from the existing retaining wall, which was, yeah.
Right here, yeah, so it looked like it was cut and then graded.
Flattened, yeah, and it's exposed, right?
No, it's basically, it was a drop.
Vertical wall.
Wall before too, so it was flat already.
Yeah.
So all you did was remove the vegetation in there?
Yes.
I see.
So it looked like this. Wall here, I think the wall's gone now.
Take some pictures.
Yeah, so, looks like this, and this fill was probably placed here, and you got a new wall coming in.
Did it just fall in, or was there fill brought in to fill the wetlands?
So it was taken down.
It looked like it was filled or just taken down?
It was taken down.
Just taken down.
Also, it was all like 1999, and all the walls were like really kind of.
What was the wall made out of?
It's a stone.
Block.
Blocks.
Kind of block, or?
No.
Interlock, yeah, interlock blocks, yeah.
Yeah.
And it was all wavy kind of, and my, I had the AC on the side, and it was going this way, cause the land was like getting slanted in.
Yeah.
So I had to put some rock on the, bottom, so that the AC basically stands on the, in a way that it should, actually, so.
So, and then, so just to, this is where it is, here's the, this is the previous wetland delineation. A wetland delineation was actually performed afterwards, and there are flags out there that we saw, and
follow generally this line, I think around this area, the flags kind of almost cut this corner here.
Yeah.
Chuck, would you, it basically went like this instead?
Yeah, very
yeah,
close.
It was very close all the way across.
Yeah, so this would be the new line as delineated out there currently.
Right.
So.
Also, when this was presented in back in 99, if you look at the 190, that looks like the existing at the time 100-year floodplain,
mm-hmm.
and part of the house and any land adjacent to that retaining wall was in the floodplain, so that when they cut that those two or three elevations down, they had to do a replication area, and that's what this looks
almost
like a foot.
Shootlet.
Yeah, so they did the replication
okay.
here, but they also gave the town a conservation restriction. And I think that is shown out in the field by those concrete bounds, which
yeah.
you could see.
It's
and it,
marked
and it
by this line here. You can the bounds are actually on here.
Oh, okay.
So it's marked by this pink line. So it's actually, the site was, if you look, I was looking at the order of conditions that Chuck had sent us. I think the site was like 5.1 acres when it was originally built. And so.
But that's the 2 acres, that's the two houses together.
Two houses together,
and
yes.
And his is 3.9 acres, and the other one, lot A, is 1.2 acres. So that would be
yes.
five.
Okay.
Yep.
So what? When did you purchase the home?
Last September,
October. August
2020. So it's last year.
And is it, there was an open order of conditions on this?
No, we just went
not
back.
Open.
We just went back to it to figure out why the concept be out.
So in 1999, did this plan receive a certificate of compliance?
Yes.
The house wouldn't
without that area in the front being built?
The house wouldn't have been able to be sold, right? Would have been registered.
Well, stranger things have happened.
Yeah,
strange. I understand, but.
Okay.
So when I saw it, I saw that this new retaining wall was really close to the wetlands. It would be in the 25, no disturbance.
Right.
The new one or the existing one?
The new one.
So.
And then the 35, it would also be in the 35-foot no structure zone.
So the order of conditions for the previous house, when the house was built,
mm-hmm.
actually states that the house was built on the limit of the house was for this unit was on the 35-foot line. So even that existing retaining wall that was in there was inside the 35-foot no structure line. I
don't know when we did the 25-35.
Just so we have an idea of where,
right.
where the lines are.
But I don't know when.
The house is probably on the 35-foot.
We, as a commission,
yeah.
started in you know with the 25 and the 35-foot.
And what structures what qualifies?
Well, the code says permanent concrete underground foundation, in the 35. What the bylaw says.
Now.
Now. Well, yeah, well, I don't know what it said before.
Yeah.
That's what it says now.
You said that to me at the last meeting. I looked it up, and it says more than just that.
Remember Bethune? We had that whole argument with
well,
Bethune?
I think that the people that were here at Bethune only wanted to argue.
No, I had that head wall right inside
I don't
the
have 35. My. I don't have them here right now. I don't have my iPad, but it says more than just, it says foundation, it says other things in it, too.
I thought it said permanent concrete underground foundation.
Are you talking about the bylaws or the?
The bylaws.
The bylaws are here.
Our regs say
yeah, what are
to protect the integrity of the zone of natural vegetation, including the associated root system and canopy. No new foundations, including footings, frost walls, or other in-ground structures, shall be permitted within 10 feet of the ZNV. So that's the additional 10 feet between 25 and 35.
So an in-ground structure kind of captures what's left.
Well, retaining, it might, may or may not, I guess you could argue it both ways on a retaining
yeah.
wall.
I think, yeah. It's vague, maybe.
Yeah, you could argue that both ways, but.
So,
I'm not, that doesn't qualify here anyway.
Chuck, the enforcement order, what is the date of the enforcement? Oh, it's June 23rd. Sorry, I see it. Have all of the conditions on page 3 been met? Like, did, was hay, was hay spread out on the upland area?
No.
Okay, to stabilize. And was erosion control installed?
It was installed, but not correctly.
Okay.
It wasn't towed in, there was a silt fence.
Okay, at the edge of disturbance. And the other item, the next item here, it says owner must present a site restoration plan. Is this what you're talking about for a site restoration plan?
So actually, previously we had planned on bringing in Rich from the LDC, and I talked with Chuck quite often, basically, what, because it's our first time buying a house, we have no idea, and it's always kind of pretty moving the hearing and everything. It was like $500 just to bring him to just sit with us. It's like, okay, and I was like, okay, and I did talk to Chuck and them yesterday, so would it be worthwhile basically spending $500 just for him to stay in? Just not present anything, he wouldn't have anything to present. We and cut just come and sit the way we were, and he said that would probably be not be worthwhile basically if you're just doing that, not presenting anything with us. So he suggested that we basically come and understand how things goes and everything. So,
okay.
And just have this plan and a basic idea of what we're planning to do and just.
Okay.
I think part of the goal tonight is to find a plan that the commission would accept to
restore.
So
yes.
Let me.
Yeah.
Let me.
Well, wait a minute.
Before we get there, there's a couple questions I have. There's an old wetland line. The wetland that was delineated by Rich Kirby from LEC just recently, is that closer to the house now,
yes.
Chuck?
The Rich Kirby line is closer to the house only on the corner here. This is the Rich Kirby line, essentially.
Okay.
Yep.
All right. And my feeling was it looked like there was wetland vegetation along that line. Is that your feeling?
Yeah.
Yes.
I mean, I think it's.
Answer.
I think it's accurate.
Okay. And that could be a function of more impervious surface as more things get developed in the town and start to contribute to, you know.
Storage.
Yeah. I mean, that could.
More intense rain events, too.
Yes, which we have been observing. So I feel that was the wetland line. So. What I saw was a structure, well, very, you know, disturbance of vegetation, which we, you know, keep a 25-foot no disturbance zone, and then the 35 feet no structure zone. So I think we would need something to come back to that 35 feet and a little bit closer to the house.
Can I ask a quick question? The black sort of thick line, that's labeled existing staked hay bales with silt fence near Mike. Yep. Yeah, this black dash line. I guess I'm trying to get a sense of what the backyard is like, how much of that is existing lawn, and where does the brush begin?
So is this the black line you're talking about?
No. Actually, I was talking about, excuse me, Mike. I was talking about
Anika,
this.
That was the old silt fence line when they constructed,
okay.
And they needed that for the compensatory storage that's hatched.
Okay.
That's why.
Then these bounds, do they go through, is that the limit of lawn?
No.
No.
It's not, because there was tree cutting.
No.
Right?
There was this retaining,
far as we can understand, there was this retaining wall here, and it was dropped into
what?
Really pretty, yeah, low.
Overgrown.
Yeah, overgrown.
Low herbaceous and bush cover.
And this area was sloped grass? What was
yes,
this?
Yes, it was just a slope, it was a grass,
a
and then. Because
on the right side over here, it was pretty much to the level of this, and it would slope a little bit, and this would be almost, because this is a wall almost like 4.5 feet or something,
yeah.
And it was like a drop down.
Yeah.
So this part was pretty much that way, and it's slope, and from here, it's almost to the height of the land.
Right.
194
right.
to 190.
But I'm trying to get an idea of the existing lawn. What's the extent of
it? Where was lawn? Exactly.
Versus.
There was, it seemed like there was none.
That's
the whole purpose.
Because all that 25 feet, no vegetation.
It was
no
all.
Disturbance of
it
the
was
vegetation.
A solid.
They did.
Yes.
What happened was a lot of invasive Japanese knotweed and a lot of poison ivy. So it was overgrown, is my understanding. Even
yes,
kind of right up to the house.
Yeah.
You
went
got
to twice a month because we didn't even realize that, and she still
yeah.
has all the marks and everything. Mm. And we see the snake right in front of her. Stairs every time we try to get out, so you can't go from the back nor from the front. We had a, like 3.9 acres, that is a conservation
gotcha.
thing, but we just wanted to have a little bit of safe side because we were planning on having a baby, and we just didn't feel safe like having. So if we have a lawn, we can at least like mow once a week so we know the surrounding. On top of that, we have all the bushes and everything, the knotweeds
mm-hmm.
and everything that grows like crazy, and it's just like overgrows everywhere.
Yeah.
So we can't see or anything, and we're planning on having that wall over there so that we don't send any of the materials out in the wetlands. And we had an impression because the other people had like a fence round to this post on the other side too, so we thought that that was where we could get till. We didn't have any, and that was the impression. So we are trying to be inside the post, create that, and level it a little bit. And just create a lawn and basically have some garden
fence
vegetables
around.
And on the end. So
that's the idea.
That was the idea.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay.
So everything has been cut from the old retaining wall out to the new retaining wall. That's exposed dirt. There is a silt fence, but the toe hasn't been. The bottom hasn't been towed into
yeah.
the ground, so
yeah, I was planning on taking care of that.
But
Chuck
but
told me how to do it. Yes. So
I'm still hung up on the floodplain because I think if because I just pulled up the FEMA map on my phone, and I know you guys can't see this, but so there's a blue
mm-hmm.
zone and then there's a rust colored zone.
Yeah.
The blue zone is a 1% probability of a flood. And the rust color is a 0.2%, which I took to be the 100
and 500
year.
It's 1% each year. It's 100 and 500.
Which makes me think that what we're talking about as floodplain here is really the 500 year, not the 100 year.
But that really
it's
we're
a,
not
it's a stamped plan, and it says 100 year flood zone. There's a line on it, so I don't know.
I'm just trying to find a solution because if we could say that this isn't an issue of floodwater displacement.
Well,
that's
you know
not
what?
The bigger issue.
It gives you different options to remediate the bordering vegetative wetland.
It certainly does. I'll just let you guys go on.
No, I mean, I'm open to.
I was just
going to
say
that
there's no way. This commission can figure out what his plan should look like.
Yeah.
Your only thing you should do tonight is decide whether there is some flexibility with what they want and what we want, or there's none and it has to be restored. And that's really what the discussion should be about.
I don't think we have to decide that tonight. If the applicant wants,
he wants
to submit
to know.
A plan.
He doesn't want to spend any money unless the commission can say, look, you can't do it.
My feeling is you can't have a structure closer within the 35 feet of your existing wetland now that Mr. Kirby had identified. So to me that means that
retaining wall on the outside needs to be removed.
So,
okay, 35 feet, so that, I mean, 35 would basically mean right at the house.
So that's why I was mentioning the 35 foot, you know, I would be under the opinion that the existing retaining wall was there. If it would be repaired to back to its original condition, I would be fine with that. That's on the 25-foot line, about on the 20-foot.
Is it?
Yeah, I mean,
oh,
it's probably.
Okay.
But the old 25-foot line, right, or the
actually,
new?
That wouldn't be correct.
Because
we measured the 25 feet from the demarcation boundaries, the cement boundaries. And that was still outside where that was, where the old thing was. So, and the wetland line is actually out further outside than those concrete bounds.
No, when we were measuring yesterday, we were measuring from the wetland line, weren't we?
Yeah, I think
we measured from the LEC
yeah.
wetland line.
Okay.
And
all right.
And your 25-foot marks that you made in the dirt
yeah.
were farther from the house than the old retaining wall.
Right.
True.
Okay.
I think a couple of them were right on it.
I'm
okay.
not getting that in my head. I'm sorry, spatially.
Yeah, so we measured out from the curvy line, which is right here, so 25 feet. I'm going to say we were close.
Yeah, I think out here it was more, just like it would presume. Right here it's probably right on it.
Yeah.
And then out here, it probably gets further away.
Yeah.
So there is a portion of this that is within that 25 to 35 foot zone. What I'm saying is, I would be, because it was there already existing, I'm fine with it staying in that zone if it's a rebuilding that structure.
I see what you're saying. So the. So this piece. Which was the existing, the first retaining wall is right.
This is the retaining wall, right?
Yep. So rebuilding that, keeping this as natural vegetation, and then, so it goes all the way up like this.
You know, we get more and more unsure.
As you get
yes.
the
yeah,
other way, let's worry
area.
About the one side of the house
very
to start.
Conceptual.
I think I agree with Mike. If that was pre-existing, I think that would be okay to go ahead and recreate that and then start from there with whatever else their plan's going to be in
yep.
terms of bring the site up to snuff.
Beyond that, I would... Propose like I wouldn't for a restoration, but I wouldn't want to see, you know, just like we always have, you know, any impacts to vegetation within the 25 foot zone and no structures within the 35 foot zone. If there's a plan to do something otherwise, I'd be completely open. You know, whether it's you know, I guess grass between the 25 and 35. We typically allow that, so I'd be open to that, you know, a restoration that includes that.
You mean on the top of the wall
on
to the house?
On the top of the wall,
from
back to the house, the sides of
the
house.
The top of the wall, back to the house, and then
side
as you turn the corner
the
as well. So, you know, here's the 25-foot line from here in as well. If that's proposing to be grass, I wouldn't have any issues with that.
No, I wouldn't either. That's, I think if you give somebody some even 10 feet of usable space, it's going to help prevent down the road from then a future violation.
Yep, exactly.
If you go right up to that house and he sells the house in a year, we're going to be back here. Somebody else is going to be trying to fill that in and grade it off as well.
Yep.
Can I ask one question about there was some discussion yesterday when we came around, the sloping down behind the house going back towards the driveway. With what you just proposed, put it back what was existing, would you also say that you can't come around that corner and come back up towards the driveway and have the wall just dead end into the banking? Or do you propose ending it essentially where that line is?
In the front, you're talking about the
back.
Driveway?
It's in the back.
So you had said before that you wanted
has, I mean, if I could, I mean, let's say I take all this back.
Yeah.
This is the retaining wall that was there, so this will probably go over here.
Yeah.
You don't want any structures in the 25-foot zone, basically, so this will still be within 25, right here. And what I was saying is, because the only reason why we wanted to have that one, we wanted to have a little fence, because you said there'll be like coyotes and everything, and we don't want to have a child, we're planning on having a child, so we didn't have one at, say, all the coyotes and everything right behind us without any fence or anything. So, and all the people, everyone would have, has a fence about on this area. So we're planning on basically having a wall at least. And if I have this wall and just plant your native plants over here, and that'll still be like 4.5 feet or something, drop over here, which would still go till the drop is still here, because it's a slope. And I was thinking if I could basically get the wall within 25 feet over here, and here, not have any wall, but still fill it up a little bit without any wall or anything, just slope it up, and have the, and so that, because if it's 4.5 feet, you know, this is a land, and you have a 4 feet land, and the other land goes over here, if you wanted to have a fence, and I don't see how it's gonna go along with this drop of 1.5 feet right there, right here after this. So I was trying to fill this up a little bit. If I could make a slope, try to go it that way, and so that I can have a straight fence like this, and use these as all the plantings and everything that you would ask me to do, put everything out there, you know, without creating any wall or anything. I mean, the wall would be till here, and the rest would just basically fill up, create a little slope, so everything goes on that side, and basically plant as a mitigation, basically, and try to weed all the Japanese, whatever you want, need to look around and try to weed those kind of things. So that is one of my proposals, if I could. And so that way, I just don't have to just like go down and come up with nothing, because this is just like a feet or two as we get up down the stairs of my back porch. So that way I'll still have like a little bit of lawn, I have grass and everything, garden vegetables or whatever I want somewhere around here. So
just to be clear, it sounds like you're saying you'd like to see fill between that 25 foot and the conservation bounds. You'd like to try and add some fill.
Some about this right here, this
yeah.
part
because
right here.
It's kind of like,
it's almost like
on
a
this side, it's actually like 4.5 feet. And you, if you, on the other side, it's like there's nothing. It's just like gonna
drop,
you know.
It's
so
a natural slope.
Yeah, so it's like.
So if we bring something, work with like bring a slope till here, so we can at least have a fence about like this, and don't have to go through the drop of 4.5 feet or something over here. And if you want, we can plant something, native plants or anything on the boundaries, or do that kind of thing. And it'll just be grasses or after that. I mean, grasses and the native plants on the and.
But you're still in the 25 feet natural vegetation zone.
Typically, our practice has been to have no fill within the 25 foot at all.
Okay.
That the fill limits go to the 35 foot and no closer.
Okay.
That's been our practice.
So just trying to build a fence, and there was no, it would be right behind the stairs of our backyard. So
yeah, and for, you know, one of the things I've seen happen with a retaining wall type of thing where there is a big drop is if there is a fence, some people put. You know, there's all sorts of things you can do, but some people have put fencing right on top of the wall.
Yes, the wall would till go till here because I can't build any.
Right, right.
So it's
right.
A drop after that,
right.
Like 4.5 feet or something. So
right.
And people have like a wall about from this post, so I thought that that was my impression basically. We could at least have a fence as others, neighbors basically.
So just to be clear, your neighbors have fencing between all of their conservation restriction?
I have no idea how.
Or you don't know?
I've seen the wall basically, but I haven't. I don't want to go to the neighbors and how they did it or whatever. I just don't. I'm just saying. I just don't want.
Yeah.
Put
yeah.
that. In. I mean, I just want to be concerned on mine.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah.
That's back there.
Is it as far back?
It's
yeah.
would be a continuation of their granite bounds. It's past the other granite bounds.
So it looks like the conservation restriction line, it just does that isn't necessarily a resource boundary that
no.
we need to pay attention to at all.
Well, we do need to pay attention to it. I mean,
we do need
to
pay attention to it, but it's not a
right.
But it's
not
a resource area
right.
definition. It has its own jurisdictional issues, but you know, I would be comfortable seeing some sort of lawn up to some sort of plan for fill, wall, fence, whatever, up to that 25-foot line.
That's gonna be less, like I think maybe a foot or two from our porch, I guess.
I think based on
but,
where
but
we marked
not according,
it.
But not according to what I see on the plan here. The blue line that Chuck drew with a marker. With
that does go a little farther than what you said. This is what we had to come when we drew this. This was the line that Chuck and I did. So
what I mean is the blue one he drew tonight in
yes.
marker.
So I mean that looks a little further away from what we had marked yesterday.
Yeah, and I don't know the scale of the
yeah.
map, so I can't
yeah.
tell you.
Yeah, I can't tell you.
Yeah. You know.
So the yellow line is the 25 feet from the flags.
I don't know.
Well, is it probably? Well,
yeah, supposed
I mean,
to be
here.
The distance doesn't match up. This is further than this. I mean, that could have just been an approximation. I think what we want to see is a plan that shows the 25-foot line.
Yep. I don't know. Yeah. I don't know what we're talking about because we don't have a plan in front of us.
Exactly. I think what we want to see is a plan with the 25-foot line. If
off of the current wetland delineation flags.
I mean, unfortunately, I know you just bought the house and everything, but you're going to have to come up with some sort of plan and a delineation with wetlands flags and descriptions of, you know, proposals of what you want to do and how you plan on doing it, and we can address it. I think we already said that I think most of us feel okay with rebuilding that wall, which already is something that the board doesn't do very often. So I think if you can rebuild that wall and then make the rest the best you can, is give us a proposal or we'll want to look at it, I think.
What you
want to
do outside that 25-foot line. 25-foot line.
Yeah, because once you talk to someone, once you hire whoever you're going to hire and Chuck has a conversation with them, you'll get a feel for what you can and what you can't do.
I mean, basically, feels from this conversation is it's almost impossible for me to basically go beyond the 25 line.
That's correct.
Yes.
And to pull back that structure that's already you've put out there.
Yes.
The wall.
And the fill.
I don't know that there's fill up there.
Well, there's
about
stone dust
underneath
the wall.
Well, it's a pretty substantial little berm.
Right.
It is. Okay.
So you'll have to clean that up and replicate and stuff like that.
All right, I think.
Chuck, do you have some comments?
No, I just have you guys give some direction. They're under an enforcement order, and you would like to, by a certain time, see a plan or have a restoration plan. And maybe you want to explain the difference between each, or maybe I could. So in my mind, a plan would come from an engineer. It means you're going forward with your project. You're trying to capture everything you want with a designer and an engineer, and then you'll bring it to the commission. But if it was a restoration plan.
Landscape architect?
A landscape architect. Or if you decided that it doesn't make any sense, there's really not a lot to gain here, and you could just take one of the plans that we have, town hall, and mark it up yourself on how you were going to restore the area and bring it back to its original condition.
So the other thing to keep in mind is while you did cut a lot down, you didn't get the roots. So you've got that Japanese knotweed and poison ivy. It's all going to grow back if you just throw some wildflower seed mix in there, right? It's not going to be as easy to fix as giving it a good job with a rake and putting a few things in.
Yeah, you've kind of opened up something that, you know, it's going to be hard to maintain at this point. So the seed bank that exists in the ground right now is all the material that you don't like, poison ivy, the Japanese knotweed, all those invasives. And if you just stopped doing anything and let things grow in, which is not an option, but if that's what you did, you would get all that material back. So I was talking to you about, you know, where you are with this project and how much it costs to move forward, which you may want to do, and how much it's going to cost to restore it. Both are going to cost some money because it can't be left the way it is.
Yes.
So you need to figure out what that balance is.
Do you have any other questions or?
Maybe you might. I think one of the things we talked about, which would be interesting in case you did want to move forward, maybe they could recommend some other consultants that have been here before, or name three or four off that they can choose.
Do we have in your office, do you have a sheet of accepted, rather than board members making recommendations up there, maybe it should be a sheet in your office of recommended
We do.
We have a bunch of consultants that present before us. I mean, it's not that we're recommending them. I mean, we could give them a list that
He has the list, right?
Yeah.
I mean, we're not in the business of you know, consulting you on who's the best to go with.
But at the same time, we're like very new and we don't
So we'd like to help you out to some degree.
Just so everyone understands why this is more complicated and I jumped into that part. The homeowner here has a golden touch. The people he calls are the biggest companies and seems to be very expensive.
I
told him to try to get a one-man shop for this and see that's what the problem is. There's 10 or 15 people on the list. I can only hand it to him.
I would just use your eyes and ears from the meeting tonight.
Doug can.
Chuck.
It's Doug is fine. Call me Doug. That's fine.
Can we point out maybe five people on the list that are doing work in this that we see in front of this commission most often?
I'm not sure.
I haven't seen this list of 15 names, so I don't know.
Exactly.
I think if it was me, I would have a little bit of education about what's happening now, and I would say things like, how much do you charge to go to a meeting? How much do you charge for delineation? Because those are the two numbers you actually have.
Have you done work in Reading? You know, yeah. you need to ask the question.
That was the same question I asked, and the first one was Rich, and he seemed to know Chuck and everyone. It was like, oh, I found someone who knows everything.
Yeah.
That's good. And I tried a couple of people and didn't pick up the phone and everything, and it was like almost a week or so, and he was there the first time, the first one, and it seemed nice and everything, and
I think you felt under the gun because it was an enforcement order, probably.
Yeah, and that was kind of like a little bit of
so,
scary.
Yeah.
We have them.
Well, could he go to the MACC website and find a wetlands?
I was thinking
no,
that,
there's some good ones on our list.
Okay.
I mean, I don't think he has to go any further than that.
Okay.
I mean,
so
it's just we need to just get.
I mean, he might go too far afield.
I was in Redding.
Yeah.
I thought that would make sense for him to basically be working here more often because he was just in Redding. The other one was tried was one Woburn, Ellen and Majors, and that was in Woburn, so that was like close by, and I thought that they would be working
right.
Close enough. So that was my thought process.
The list is fine. I think you should reach out to get some quotes because you will find that price varies, particularly depending on the size of the firm.
And
so it's worth looking to get some quotes.
Absolutely. No, now I get it. It was, I mean, my first time having it. We just bought, it was the first house we bought a couple of months back, and almost alien things for us, basically everything. So that was the thought process. Now I know a little bit more. Probably we'll go ahead
in
that one.
So Chuck, in the meantime, what's the typical timetable on?
I would think that we'd want to see them within two meetings at least.
Within two meetings.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So a month from now.
Okay.
Months.
Yeah.
And
I agree.
In the meantime, because right now it's.
So what I'm getting from my limited knowledge from this meeting is we basically, I only have an option of basically restoring it the way it was before.
Not necessarily,
yeah,
because...
Yeah, you might be able to get something additional, but I think, you know, you are new to this whole wetlands thing, and I think you need some professional help if you are going to go forward with some kind of a plan. I really do, and I'd be willing to go three meetings.
So three meetings puts us the first week of September.
No, probably. Next one is the last meeting in August.
Okay, because we're coming up at that point, we start hitting the planting.
If I may,
you know, good planting season.
Go up to October 15th.
I don't know. I mean, how that would be just leaving the.
Yeah, well, I think that's a different issue. I think what we have to do is require certain remediation relatively soon, meaning hay bales and hay on the ground to prevent any stormwater from running, washing all that soil into the resource area.
Well, if you just towed in the silt fence, the bottom of the silt fence, because it's
yes.
just sitting there.
Yeah, I'm just going to
just tow it in.
Trends
and you
like
don't need
to
hit hay.
So that retaining wall is going to basically is a barrier. And until that's removed, there's no way for any of that soil to get into the wetland. There's a little bit in back of it.
No, I understand that, but that's going to come out at some point, so you're going to need the hay bales anyway, right?
I don't know if there's a
plan from someone. Right,
so tow in the silt fence.
Two meetings, I think, is the best thing. We want to tow in the silt fence.
We want anything on the exposed soil.
Well, the enforcement order calls for hay to be
right.
spread. So that needs to happen.
No, it doesn't need to happen.
You don't think so based on this, though?
I think that...
And wouldn't you want straw anyways instead of hay?
Probably been like that for quite a while, right, Jeff?
I don't think the soil's going anywhere, and I'm hearing that there's a, you know, like, let's keep the cost down kind of a sense, all right? I don't think it's needed. I think it says it there. It's boilerplate.
Okay.
There's a lot of things that don't have to be done. Tow in the erosion control and figure out what you're going to do.
And
then just make sure we have a clear plan of moving forward. And I'm not sure that's out there yet. Like, what's the plan? And so I'm just going to say you need to come up with a plan before you do the work. Because now the commission's involved. So we want to know what you're going to do. So you can't do anything except make sure there's no erosion between now and the next meeting. So you're in limbo again. You can't move anywhere on this project.
Yeah, I understand that one, yeah.
My suggestion is to find someone you can work with. Doesn't have to be the entire team, engineer and all that, and guy that's going to make a plan, but maybe someone that can talk to you and tell you what he thinks and what he can do for you, and you guys will have to weigh the numbers again and decide whether you want to move forward with the project or move forward with the restoration. But whichever way you're going to go, you'll need a consultant to help you, because it's not okay to allow that area that you just disturbed to grow completely back in with invasives. So when we say restore it, it needs to be kind of like what it was. It was a little bit of invasives, but a lot of native plants. It really has to be that again if you're going to restore it.
Okay.
All right.
So you want us to restore before we come to the meeting?
No.
Anything you do, you need to let Chuck know, and we're looking for, you know, a plan before you really do anything. I think the only thing we're looking for you to do at this point is to tow in that silt fence, leave the area, and get professional representation, somebody to help you decide what you want to do.
Whether it's restoring to the original or some sort of improvement, whether it's in the back there.
You were saying like we need two meetings, so that's gonna
no.
That's just time. They're just giving you a
time
month to get this together.
We want it before then.
Oh,
yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Oh, so if we are ready for the plan and all that, can we
come right in?
Come right in.
Yeah.
The earlier the better for us.
Oh,
we just don't
let me know.
Okay,
but
we don't want someone.
I thought this is only for the monthly thing, and
we
have to wait
so
for like
this
2 months. That's
we meet the second and fourth Wednesday of every month, typically.
Twice a month.
If we have a quorum.
He'll basically arrange this again.
Well, we could actually ask them to come in at the next meeting, and if they're not ready, we can continue it at that meeting to the following.
I would love that, yeah.
Okay.
Okay.
So that's the 27th, I believe.
Online. If you have a potential person you want to hire, they could review to see what we said on their own.
On RCTV, through YouTube.
Yeah.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh.
Yes.
Well, okay. So
you could
hire him and say, hey, spend 20 minutes, watch the meeting, you'll know what the board's looking for.
I
don't know. Okay.
All right, so I think we're done.
Okay, so
someone make a motion to do all that, what we talked about.
We
need a motion to
he wants to make his first motion.
What are we moving?
Yeah, what are we motioning?
We have an enforcement order out there. You need to take the next step. So make a motion to the applicant come back to the next meeting, which is the 27th.
I'll make a motion to have the applicant come back the next meeting. In the meantime, between those 2 weeks, make a motion that you tow in the silt fence and make it effective so that no silt gets into the resource area. And
and request when you come back
at
you
the
come
next
back
meeting,
with a
we
plan.
Like
say come
a,
back
a,
2 weeks just to give us a report.
A plan. You want a plan of either restoration or
a plan of what you're going to do, or I want a report on you're working on trying to get it done.
I'll second.
All those in favor? Abstain. Or
you guys can give me a call tomorrow if you're
baffled.
Or when you get a hold of somebody, he can call me too.
You know,
that's why I like my motion. It's baffling.
It's not your motion.
That was just here?
Yeah.
That's Jack Sullivan.
You
he's an engineer.
Give me
the
one.
So we
could
call it
back. Yeah, you should have. Yeah, there was a guy here named Jack Sullivan. I have to tell you, unfortunately, I know he's going on vacation for a couple weeks, but
thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you guys. Good luck.
Good night.
Thank you.
Number
I'm not so sure you have poisonous snake. I was looking at my reptile book.
We saw the garden one,
but the last time when I was walking, it was not like this morning. It was the garden one, but the last time, the two times that we see it, is it kind of funny shape to it?
We just don't go near to, and we see it from
it was big, and it was just like it was hovering by. So I didn't.
And they hiss.
I was so scared of the snake, so I didn't even try to go closer. It was just.
Don't say you saw anything. It might be an endangered species.
Yeah.
We're not there to harm them, but at the same time, we don't want it so close.
You're very close to nature back there.
It is. It's a good thing. But certain things like bees, you really don't want to be safe too.
You know,
right.
It's like you definitely love to be close to nature, but you want to be safe.
Right.
When I was a kid, I wanted to be a herpetologist. I wanted to study reptiles.
Oh, really?
Yeah. And I used to catch snakes like that and bring them in my mother's kitchen and say, look, Mom.
I should probably call you to kind of see it.
I'd probably like to catch it, but probably.
All right.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, no problem. Okay.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Have a good night.
Good luck.
Thank you.
Okay. Any administrative reports?
Yeah, I'd like to ask the commission about our town is trying to do a paperless policy or try to become as paperless as we can. So I'd like to ask each one of you if you require your applications and plans in PDF form, or would you prefer them in paper? So I already know that our newest member, Dave, would like everything in paper, which is fine. And this is not something you have to do. This is in the hopes that there is somebody here that likes it electronic, so we can save the postage and some paper. So... anyways,
what you just said, you can send this to me electronically and in email any way you want in the format, but if I do a site visit or for a meeting, I'd like to have a paper in front of me, not an electronic copy.
Paper plan and the paper plan and the application?
Yes.
So I'm not, I wouldn't, so they get sent out on the Wednesday and you're at the first site work on the Sunday, I wouldn't be able to get that to you, but I can send everyone everything electronic,
right.
And then again, paper plans and paper application for Dave.
Chuck, at this stage, I would prefer paper.
Okay, hold on a sec. So Becky is.
Pick it up. I don't have to have it set.
Okay, and Anika.
The same. I prefer paper. And
paper
I'll,
and
I'm
paper.
Happy.
I'm happy
to pick
carbon
it up
credits. I'll. Yeah. Okay.
I don't have to send it by mail.
Am I making more work if it? I don't need an application. As long as I have a plan and the.
No, I'm happy to do
agenda.
Half. Yeah.
If I had a printed agenda and plan, I can have the, everything else like.
Oh, you like the agenda printed, huh?
Yes. That's more work than just do print the whole thing printed, but notice of intents would like.
Are you talking about trying to get rid of these packages, Chuck? Is that
as much weight in those packages as I can? I'm trying to get rid of.
I don't
so
need.
So wait a minute. Let me just finish. Mike wants a printed agenda. Are you here? And what was the rest? Printed.
Just plan.
And then just the plan. Okay, good. Okay, and Al.
I'll take it all electronically and print out.
You're the man.
What I think I need.
You're the man. Great. And if anyone feels like
Becky and all the sidewalks, so I can look at her.
Yeah, right.
So for all you guys that are like hovering around town, just give me a call and you can get your plans, or Ann's there. Or you can just show up, and if one of us is there, we'll pull out the plans. Because I intend to get
a
hard copy of, at least a hard copy of each one. So there will be something there we can just pick up.
Should it be the mailbox in City Hall where we can pick up and drop off documents? I guess we just leave a basket on the desk with a candle on the counter or something, right? Marked conservation.
There's a pickup bin and everyone will get you whatever you want, but it's not on the counter. It's in back of the counter.
So Chuck, are you saying we're not gonna be mailing these out anymore?
No,
what I'm saying is I wanna make sure that I'm not doing it
if you don't have to.
You know, if I don't
so
have
So you're
to.
Saying...
Do you want paper or electronic copies of the application?
Or plastic.
That's what I'm saying.
So you're still able to mail out exactly what you've been doing?
Yep.
Okay. I will try all electronic.
Well, I could try the electronic. I could bring my iPad on the site visits.
Yeah, my wife has an iPad.
Brian Sullivan used to bring his laptop or his iPad to the meetings.
Yeah, bring the iPad if I want to blow something up to look at, because the phone's a little small.
I'm fine with trying. And if you're going to do that, are you going to just email PDFs, or are you going to do the Google Docs thing?
And you can. I'm not going to hold you to it. It's always fine. You know, we can.
So you thinking though the Google thing?
How are you gonna send us electronic
stuff?
Them.
He might be receiving electronic
copies. We asked.
Copies, so he might just
I was told
them
that Google Docs would be the best, but then Harry said he couldn't look at Google Docs
at work. No, I'm willing to try.
Okay.
I'm willing to try anything.
Okay. Well, let's try with Google Docs.
That's
you give it that one.
Because I can get it at home if I can't get it at work. I'll figure out a way to make it work.
And David, you wanted both.
You can yes. You can send me to electronically, but I, the same, I can come pick my paper copy up. You don't have to mail mine.
How many printed agendas do we need? Anika, you wanted a printed agenda?
You know what, I don't need a printed agenda because, I mean, I think between the packet and the meeting, there's a revised one emailed to me. Most of the time anyway. So
this is
just email the email agenda's fine.
Okay. Okay. So email an agenda. I only have Mike that wants a printed agenda. Oh, I have Becky too. Saw that look.
He didn't even have to look up and he saw the look.
and Mike Dave. So it's Harry and Al, and I'm going to say Amy, but that's it.
My son's got a new iPad that he can write right on the iPad.
Really?
Yeah. That would be, I'll just, like, I'm
all
taking
right,
off
so
my agenda here.
Right on
just, my wife's been bugging me to get, I need a new computer anyway, so maybe I'll just get that new iPad.
So I'm just going to tell you the way I feel about it, because we were asked once at a place that I was at for my meetings, and I felt like I didn't need my application or my plans because unlike Anika, who writes all over them, and you know, because you're using them, right?
Yeah.
And then she's marking up the plan. That's how she kind of gets involved and thinks about it. She's right in there and she's marking the plan and I didn't need that. I could just look at it. I could read it. And so that's why I decided to go electronic. Plus I had the iPad. And I can just pull it up. So I'm not pulling papers and trying to figure out where they are at my desk or they in the car or they're at here. So it was, for me, all that convenience was very helpful. So that's why I went
paperless. Yeah, I think
went paperless.
It would be fine for me.
I just think it's the small size. That's terrible. But most of these projects are like homeowner houses. There's not really a lot involved.
Anika's going to need shoulder surgery pretty soon from carrying that.
Oh, I thought you knew something. I was like,
I'm dumping some of it tonight, so sorry.
No, don't just keep it though, because that's the vault. When I'm missing something, I ask Anika for it.
Any emergency permits?
There are none.
Bills?
There are none.
Okay. The minutes. Are you gonna make the changes to the minutes?
It's all on me.
Okay.
So you have to take those minutes that you have and change them on. Oh, you can't. Can you do that?
I can't. I've got some notes. You can take them. I don't know.
I'll take notes. I just won't write notes because it's too hard for it to happen that way. So if you have a note, I'll take it. Or if you have track changes, I'll take it.
Let me, is there, Mike, you might know this, or somebody might know it. Is there software available to go from audio to paper? Could we record it and then transcribe it to paper?
The minutes?
Yeah.
It's probably.
There are. Voice recognition.
That's what I mean.
You mean transcribe
text.
The entire meeting?
Yeah, transcribe the entire meeting to paper. I mean, that's what they want, right?
Well, I think the intent, I mean, if that's what they want, why don't we just have
we
the video as the minutes?
Yeah, they don't want the video as the minutes, right?
That's an excellent suggestion.
Yeah.
I mean, it's probably made 100 times, but we just had a meeting about what people can do. And little suggestions that are coming up with. Oh, if they, isn't there a town you were telling me about that's how they do their minutes? There's nothing.
They never
written.
Transcribe them. I had to pay to have them.
They just record.
They just record them and take the little tapes
and
put
that's
them
it.
In an archive.
Well,
so why is the video not okay?
I think it is. It's the powers that be, right? The selectmen and somebody else.
I don't know how
to
that works. I don't know how you'd have to like adopt something and then. Bring it forward.
I don't think
works.
You get much more accurate than the video.
Yeah, I don't either. I mean, what's the sense?
Well, so what are we adding in content to these minutes? I guess versus a video, and how often are we going back?
That's only for this.
If somebody's requesting that we go back, aren't we going back to the meeting minutes?
Times we've had questions since I've been on the board, we go back to
the
video. The
video. You're right. No, you're
let,
absolutely
let me,
right.
Let me just say, I think I see the value of a written. One is you don't have to fast forward and or watch the entire video. Like you've got almost the executive summary of the video that you can just flip through and go, I don't care about this, I don't care about that. It takes 3 seconds.
Well,
you go,
that's a,
it captures this is what I was interested in. I wanted to see if this detail was in there. It is or it isn't.
So what
and if you've got a question, then go to the video.
What else isn't captured in there? We do track attendance. You know, so, but maybe we can simplify it so that it's not notes. You know, there are certain points that I think I did at one point that I had a question for Chuck, but you were doing a good job of taking notes. I think it's too difficult for you to worry about noting what conversation's going on and.
Well,
and
this is the first one. I mean, let's just check it out in a couple months. I mean,
but if we can simplify, if we can simplify our meeting
comes
minutes,
in here and there's 30 people in here,
yeah.
And we have a 2-hour meeting, it's going to be tough to take minutes.
Oh, they're
going to
be very simple minutes at that point.
Well, I think, you know, if we wanted to generate some sort of a skeleton from the agenda that for our night, so that people could look at the video and see what matters we got to, we could just write a time. Of when we started each of the matters on our agenda, and people could go to the video. You know, there's ways around this that could be pretty straightforward.
Meeting minutes were never intended to be a total transcription of every word that was said. They're basically an outline and a skeletal history of what occurred in the meeting. That 20-minute discussion that we had with the last applicant could be reduced to 3 sentences.
Right. Mm-hmm.
So.
Well, prior to this, when we had help, we were transcribing word for word.
Yeah, and I don't
we
think
weren't.
It was ideal.
We were or we
well,
weren't?
We
weren't.
No.
We'll have this out to you tomorrow, what I have here. And everybody add what you think happened. Send it to me separately. And I'll consolidate it and bring it to the meeting. And actually, I'll consolidate it, put it in the packet, and then we'll discuss it at the next meeting.
Okay.
Can we also send you potentially a simplified version if we've got it and say, well, this
yeah,
may
Mike,
be
you can make it as difficult as possible. You got the time, go for it. I know
well,
that you're.
I think there's potential here to just.
No.
What was the order? What was the vote? I mean, do we need to get any more complex than that?
Sorry.
Because
well,
I think.
Wanted. I mean, the last applicant. You know what the issues were. And what are we asking for the next time?
I think they're going to be, you know, very brief compared to what we've been getting.
Okay.
And
then
if you guys add something to it.
They could have been brief all along.
All right, can I just throw some things out? I think we have to be careful about relying on YouTube.
because there's no consideration, we're not paying for it, and so for some reason they decide that they're not gonna archive.
I think the town does pay for that.
Do we pay to record those meetings and keep them on?
No, no, RCTV, you can get a disc.
So they're archi- see, I think we just gotta be careful that somebody has a permanent copy of the video.
Well, I'm sure they're gonna tell you that it's not their responsibility to provide that disc to you.
No, but we, you can get a disc.
Yeah, they do have them, and you're welcome to them if they have them.
So if we don't keep minutes and they keep a disc that they're not obligated to share with us on demand, then we don't have a record, right? So I think we gotta be really careful about that. I'd be interested in hearing if there's a sort of a standard at the Commonwealth that we can look to say this is what commissions need to do.
We can't make any changes anyways. If you can make a suggestion and I can run it up the flagpole and see if everybody agrees to it,
but I don't know what that suggestion should be.
We're not gonna, we're not, we can't say it's all video and that's how we're doing it. Just amongst ourselves.
So the other thing is, what I like is the idea of recording the important decisions, right? Who was there? Who voted? What was the decision? Getting that in written minutes,
yeah.
And then if there's a resource that we can rely on as a recording or a transcription to go back to in the event that there's a question about what was said, great. But I like the idea of really brief minutes where we keep track of the key things. And then have a backup of the recording of it.
You know, they used to record these meetings anyways, way back in the day, when we didn't have RCTV.
Yeah.
Take
well, that's great.
Recording.
Yep. We have a discussion on the tree policy. Did everybody review the latest draft?
Of course, I sent it out and then print a hard copy for myself because I'm Mr. Digital.
I did. I went back and looked at our meeting minutes, and I do have some comments on that. I know that we said
extra.
That we really liked the definition of the DBH that you had put in the previous version.
Okay.
You know the
16 inches.
Yeah, and I didn't see it there.
Well, I put it right here. So one or two trees, less than 5 inches in diameter at breast height, equivalent to 16 inches in circumference.
I think it needs to be up in the applicability too. And the other thing I didn't see is, and I went on online and looked at these, and that one that has the native has all of it. It has shrubs, it has herbaceous, it has ferns. And I think that a little confusing, and I know that we talked about replacement of trees with shrubs as well, and I don't see that in this.
I think we had, according to my memory, take that for what is, I think we began that discussion, and I'm not sure. I thought that was one of the items we tabled, correct me if I'm wrong, for more, until we had more members present to discuss. Because, you know, to a certain extent, a situation might call for replacement tree for tree.
That's true, but there are other indications where, and I was thinking about this a little bit more, and I was thinking about Bob Moses and one of his discussions, one of our last things, where, you know, oh, we're taking out very large trees. Now, I wouldn't want to see another large, or a capability of a tree to grow large again, because you're just defeating the purpose. So, you know, in some instances, the shrubs provides a different habitat. You know, it's that transitional habitat between forest and so that's where I was going. I was thinking about that today.
No, I'm in favor of adding a large growing shrub as
yeah. One of your in that one of those things, the first thing on the shrubs it was can grow into a tree. Forget which one it was.
You know, because some arborvitae are called shrubs, but they grow to 30 feet.
Right.
You know, so but some shrubs you can buy and they're the small variant that will stay no bigger than 4x4.
30-foot arborvitae's not gonna smash your roof in if it goes down.
Right.
So that's probably not that bad if an arborvitae goes 20 or 30 feet.
Right.
It's those 80-90-foot pine trees that everyone's scared to death of.
The white pines and
right.
Like the tree that's in their yard, their side yard.
Yeah.
You get one of those heavy wet snowstorms, that's going right towards their house.
So that's kind of where I was thinking with you know, the replacement with the shrubs. And you know, I was thinking when I was looking at, you know, New England, about Mickey Marcus's company out in Amherst, that the cost of those shrubs are about the same. And I think I went on Mahoney's or someplace else. The cost of the shrubs are the same as some of these small trees that you're
planting. You know what a lot of people are doing, and you know, I don't know, maybe the builders can tell me better, but I hear that a lot of them just ordering the stuff in a catalog or online, and they'll come in and they just plant it, and they think that that's as reasonable. So the guy at 37 James Road, Mark Fucarelli, he ordered all his plants online.
I'm
so
still
was
getting,
able to get
I'm
what
still
he wanted.
Most of all my stuff from a nursery. I don't got anything online.
Well, might be, you know, it seemed like it was a good option. You
You're also not using iPad touchscreens, though.
I'm gonna.
You know, there's many ways to go about this, and
yeah.
People have the flexibility to
pursue
it.
Give them the flexibility, but we'll give them a basic guideline.
Right.
And give them some flexibility.
Yeah.
I mean, it's still case by case with the guidelines. This isn't
yeah.
a.
I'm liking it.
Yeah, me too. I think it's.
Do you have any? Did you review it, Chuck?
I did. I even printed it out. I thought it was good. So.
I think it's fairly straightforward too. I need to keep it as simple as possible.
Well, yeah, and I think it's.
That was the goal.
Yeah, you don't want to. You know, as I was tinkering with this, I kept coming back to the idea that. You can't envision every possible scenario that someone's got going on in the backyard, and so you have to just—it's their yard. That's why we're giving them the flexibility to do it themselves. And with that comes the responsibility that if you're going to cut down a little dogwood tree and replace it with a white pine, that's on you. You can only legislate so many things. So I really think it's important to just. Give people some guidance. They can certainly come talk to us, right? And there are, you know, where we've got an RDA for where they're cutting down larger trees, they are going to be coming to us,
right.
And we're going to have the opportunity to say.
I think it's a basic guideline,
yeah.
And I think
yeah.
that's
I think
what
it's
we're
good,
trying to do.
Exactly. I think it covers that
so,
that basis,
so
and it provides a relative consistency. It gives us, again, to provide relative consistency.
I think where we need to be flexible is, you know, where. You know, you're gonna cut down something that's falling down. It's kind of close to the house, but it's in a really forested area. You may want to think about it would be difficult to jam something into that forested area. Maybe there's some place up closer to the house that you might want to plant a shrub or a tree. You know, I'd like us to see, you know, us be reasonable and come up with some suggestions. And, you know.
Don't you think that the first, last sentence in the first paragraph, commission may have sole discretion apply a different standard when conditions warrant.
Yeah.
That would kind of cover.
Yeah.
Instead of planting a tree, you're going to plant the bush.
Right.
You know, so I think
right.
that covers you on.
I'm
just exactly
generally
what you're
discussing
about.
This with the
yeah.
members.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And usually these aren't perfect natural situations.
No.
Right? So the example we had on Grove Street at the last meeting where they want to cut down a pine tree that's about this big around. 100 feet tall, it's going to be really hard to get anything to grow within 5 or 10 feet of that stump because of the rotting wood in there
right.
and everything. So maybe some blueberry bushes are a good option, and you know, something that's going to get that tall on the edge of a forested area is just going to fall over again anyway. So
my blueberry bushes are struggling.
They are.
Why?
Well, they need
to
gotta water.
I water them. I root stabilize them. I sprayed them with the bug stuff.
We need an enforcement order.
I'm trying to nurse those things along. They're hurting.
killing them with kind.
They're alive. They're alive. There's green leaves on there, but I'm not just gonna see any.
Well, it's been a tough. It's been a tough year. So the editor needs a little guidance. So one of the things I put in here, which I wasn't sure, I couldn't remember whether we were gonna require people to replace dead trees.
No.
So just alive trees. All right. So I'm just gonna say trees. Greater than 5 inches or 16-inch circumference. Is that it?
Yeah, I think that makes it simple.
Okay.
Do you have anything about shrubs in there? It's all trees?
So we could say in the last sentence, replacement trees must be native species selected from da-da-da-da-da and be at least 4 feet tall. Replacement plantings must be native species.
So the four foot tall is not a requirement, though, right?
Well, it is in this.
4 feet tall is not much of a tree.
It's not at all.
But
now I was under the impression
with a bush.
Survivability was greater with a smaller tree than a larger tree.
Right. But doesn't it separate trees and bushes?
What?
Like the tree should be at least 10 feet tall, I think. 8 feet, 8 to 10.
Why don't we go with the caliber, with either a bucket, either a 3 or 5 gallon bucket, or a 2.5 or 3.5 inch caliber.
Yeah,
at the
like
base.
We usually say 3 inch caliber.
Yeah, a 3.5.
I think that's
a 3.5 inch caliber is about a 10 or 12 foot.
Yeah,
tree.
And then what you're
but
doing is you're buying survivability.
So we said the opposite
that
last
could be,
time.
That could be 150 to 200 bucks. It's expensive.
But it's a lot less at some of the places that so like Home Depot, you're gonna get trees at
but
a third
get,
of that.
Yeah, but you're gonna get, you know, a 1.5 inch caliber. You're not gonna get a 2.5 inch calibers. That's a good sized tree. That's a 5 gallon bucket or ball, and 12 or 14 feet tall. It's a big tree. That's what I have to plant for planting around in the right of way. That's what Bob wants.
It can't always be about money. It has to be about let's do it once, survivability. What's
well,
Harry's
right.
Most?
The smaller the tree, the higher survivability rate.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't know, let's pick a 3 gallon tree with a minimum of 2 inch diameter.
But is a 3 gallon tree a standard way of ordering them or getting them?
Yeah, when you go to the nurseries, they come in buckets. They come in.
So you order a 3 gallon. It's like
a 3 gallon bucket or a 5 gallon bucket.
Okay.
Tree. That's the way they are in the nurseries. They come in, unless they're in a burlap ball.
Sorry with me. As long as someone can say, I need a 3 gallon bucket, and we come up with a standard measurement size, fine.
Well, we'll say 3 gallon bucket with a minimum 2 inch diameter, and that's probably an 8 to 10 foot tree.
And if someone calls you and says, I'm buying a.
Right. They want to dig them with a spade shovel.
You get someone that's got
native
a
dogwood
tree.
Tree.
You're not gonna put that in the
and
no,
I'm
so
looking at the root ball, and I just don't want to put people in a situation of feeling like they're guessing.
Yeah. So what do you want? Do you want to be specific?
That's why
what
I said 4 feet. It's like
4 feet. Yeah. I would be hesitant to actually require people to put in trees that are much larger, like a 3 inch diameter caliber tree. You have someone that has to plant that by hand. You're going to need 3 men and a boy to actually carry that tree and dig the hole. So.
It's not that big.
I would.
That's not. They're not that big.
Rather than the height, I would rather see caliber. I'd rather see diameter size at the trunk. That way, it could be 4 feet, it could be 8 feet, but as long. Because we want it to
matured.
Be fairly sturdy.
It's matured.
We want it
matured.
To be, you know,
it's
at least 2 inches.
2 inch diameter
a
tree?
A minimum of 2 inches, then you know it's you know, growing.
Say 2 inch caliper. That would probably do it.
Yeah.
But
I think it
captures
the bucket size, it captures my height.
Yeah, doesn't matter how big the bucket
and
or how big.
And you've brought
base,
it down from a 3, so it's not
going to
have that huge root ball.
Right.
So now you, Dave's,
I don't know.
Yeah, we can walk it over.
One person can handle planting that, dig the hole themselves.
Mm-hmm. Caliper with a P or a B?
P. Are you kidding me? I can't spell cool yet.
P.
Dave?
C-E-L-I-P-E-R.
All right, so. Replacement plantings must be native species and be at least two, do we say 2 or 3?
Two
inch caliper
at its base.
Okay. And a fern wouldn't qualify because it would never be 2 inches.
Sorry.
Okay. You guys okay? I added the column on the right, less than 200 feet from outer river. It's all either a minor project or no approval.
So one of the notes from the last meeting said cutting of a tree dead or alive within 25 foot of a wetland need to contact for at least a minor project. Do you get, what do we say about dead trees?
We said we don't have to replace them.
Yeah.
We don't have to replace them, but they are still, so that comment that they don't need to be replaced.
This is a tree replacement policy. This isn't a tree cutting down policy. So I'm not sure why that's even in there.
So that was a
tree cutting policy. So do we need to change that to tree replacement?
It's the replacement policy. I mean, I would be afraid if people could interpret this in different ways and start cutting trees down and then point to it and say, hey, this has given me the right to do it.
Okay. Well, it's what permit vehicle is, do we direct them to?
To cut down a tree.
To cut down a tree, if they want to cut down a tree. I think that
was
the whole process.
Should it be tree cutting and replacement?
Well, then what's this table?
You're within 100 feet and you want to take down a tree.
You have to contact you.
Contact me.
But so
the first sentence, which you agreed with this policy, says this policy provides guidance for people coming before the commission on when they shall seek permission to cut a tree.
And when they need
and
a
when
place.
They need
it's
plant
both.
Tree.
I mean, this whole table is the
yeah,
permit
right.
situation.
Yeah.
It's not a, it has nothing to do with just replacement. This is what permit do you get based on if you're cutting. This is a tree policy, not a tree replacement policy.
So I didn't read it closely enough.
Well,
so just to go back to the minutes,
fine.
It says there was a note here that said we were overview was given of recommendations for certain circumstances such as cutting of a tree dead or alive within 25 feet of a wetland.
Yes.
I would agree with that.
Is that?
I think we want them coming to us.
Is that pretty clear that this pertains to the cutting of tree,
we've mixed up the issues. So
yeah, well, it's the
so cutting we said was okay. Did we say it was okay? No. We didn't address whether it was okay to cut a dead tree, but what we did say is you don't have to replace
exactly
a dead tree.
Exactly. That was the stipulation.
Do you want to put the language right in there? Do you want to say any cutting or removal of any tree within 100-foot buffer zone requires that you contact the Office of the Administrator for the Conservation Commission for the town of Reading?
Well, we've got two
just
situations
be,
where
just
it says,
to be clear.
We've got two situations in this grid where it says no approval is required, so they would just go do it.
I think, yeah, I don't know. I'm sorry, I missed all that stuff. We were doing a policy based on we were inconsistent when someone wanted to take a tree down and how we were going, what we were going
right.
to do to get them to replace it. Now it's turned into like,
so
you know, a self-prescribed policy.
So to paraphrase what you just
dude,
said.
Dude, have you been reading this? We've been at this for 2 months.
No.
Yeah.
So
I mean,
that's
this
okay.
table's
so,
been in it forever.
So is the tree cutting is the tree replacement policy that any tree is replaced 1-to-1 if it was alive and it must be at least 3 inches in diameter at its base with the caliper? Is that our policy?
I mean, if that's the
I would say yes.
Yes.
Yeah.
If it's only a replacement, I think that it's
that
just that sentence
grid.
And nothing else.
That even that wasn't that what did I
you were
you,
here.
I sent you stuff of a policy on tree replacement, not a cutting policy. And it, I don't know how it turned into that. I'm sorry I didn't pay attention
that's
to
okay.
it better.
I think
that's going to be a little bit hard to. I think that's. I could just see people like when a tree comes down, they misinterpreted this policy. And we're stuck.
Well, we're never stuck. We can.
We're not stuck.
We're never stuck.
Someone that's you have something out there that says they can cut down a tree and just follow the chart.
Let's run it up the flagpole and see if that happens. If that happens 2 or 3 times, then we'll.
Then we have to revisit it.
We'll revisit it. We'll revise it. We can revise that anytime we want.
It's policy.
So are you uncomfortable if within 25 to 100 feet of a wetland resource? Somebody cuts 2 trees down that are both less than 5 inches in diameter. Would that be?
And replaces them. How do we know that happens?
We don't have a replacement for
we
that, do we?
Yeah, they would have to replace them.
They would have to replace them?
Well, that's what this says. They just don't need to come get approval
well,
to cut them down.
Then they need to come. They come to. How do you get them to replace it if they don't need to come get approval? That's saying that we've given them free will to do whatever they want in 25 to 100. That's not letting them asking them to replace it.
No, we let people drive down the road and we don't videotape the whole thing and ensure that they're obeying the law every step of the way.
We do make them get a license.
A license?
A license to, that shows that they understand the rules.
Yeah.
Makes them come in and find out.
License to drive a car. I'm like, you have to get a license to cut down a tree?
That's what we should do. We should issue photo ID tree cutting licenses.
Tree cutting companies around.
You can make some money on that.
Good. Good. $25.
Oh, my. All right. In the interest of 9:15.
Well, we got a long
way. We should look
at
this again.
I move we continue this matter.
Are we saying that it's okay to cut down the little trees in no replacement, 25 to 100 and less than 200 feet from an outer?
Well, see, less than 5 inches in diameter is not a tree according
to... It's a sapling.
It's a,
correct.
So that's why I use that.
So they don't need to replace it.
That's more of pruning of wetlands, right? That's more or wetlands or a resource area.
Well, so if you've got a... oak tree that's this
pruning
big
outside.
Around, that's 20 feet tall, out in the woods, no closer than 25 feet. This says just go ahead and cut it down and plant a replacement if you want to.
So here's the problem.
Oh, you said no approval required.
How do they determine where they are? The 25 foot is a problem. That's a skill. Probably cutting the tree down is a skill too, that size. But determining where they are is a skill. And those are a few things that you got to be careful of. And whenever they say you say replacement, how is that verified?
Mm-hmm.
So I think I said that first, Mike. You can take
so
credit.
How many
people aren't listening to you, so.
Chuck?
Since
I've been on the board, we've asked people to replace 50 or 60 trees. How many have we verified?
We do it on the certificate of compliance.
A lot of them didn't
have
certificate of compliance.
So when your tree wasn't alive over there at Bethune Way,
how many times has he bothered you about that tree?
I asked you to get a tree over there.
Right.
That's how it works.
You just remember?
No, it was on the certificate of
but
compliance.
But it's in a minor.
What about people who come before us and remove trees that don't have a?
But it's in a minor project permit. It's in an RDA.
I was involved.
There's a record
in it.
associated with it.
Yeah, if you're involved in it, that's what I'm saying. You remember.
But if there's
you're
no approval required,
that's part of it. But then,
if there's no approval required, they're just going to go out and they're going to do it. They're not going to come talk to us. They're just going to do it. And so, how do we know it gets replaced? How do we know whatever
happened? I personally don't think a sapling needs to be replaced.
Well, then that's the policy, if that's the policy, but that's not the way it's worded.
Right, it needs to be cleaned up. But either we're going to require them to for a 5-inch diameter tree outside the 25 to come in and get some sort of permit so we can verify, or we're not. I mean, that's a discussion that I guess we'll have next time. Why don't we all really read it and then talk about it at the next meeting?
That would be.
I already made a motion to continue.
I'll second that motion.
All those in favor?
I think we should hire a consultant to help us. See, I thought I got it too, guys.
It's nothing against
killing
you.
Me.
It's just like
bigger heartbreaks than this,
Harry.
Me.
It's just like it says in there. We have the right to change our mind at any time.
Is this not?
It was continued. They're not ready.
Oh, all right.
Yeah, they're not ready. That's 244 R Ash Street.
Yeah.
Yeah. The grass is like dying. All
right.
So, and the other item. We had talked about taking Jamie Mong out for dinner, and I talked to Jamie, and we kind of zeroed in on August 8th, which is a Monday.
and either Bunratty's or Petucci's. And so put that on your calendar, and I need to get, and what we do is we may ask for, you know, a few dollars or so to come up with a small gift.
For Jamie, no.
All right.
A memorial tag on a tree.
Is the
sweet pepper bush.
Are we still on?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay.
Still an open.
And he also requested that we invite Bill Heck, Will Finch, Brian Tucker, Brian Sullivan. So I'll get those numbers from you.
Yeah.
Just give him a call. That on your calendar.
Okay. Can I add another item?
Yeah.
So at the last meeting, we had one lucky person, Chris, won both the 2 hours at Matera and the sweet pepper bush.
Really?
She came by the Friday before the 4th of July, and I congratulated her. We loaded the shrub into the back of her car. And I gave her a certificate, and I made a copy of it for you to keep for your records. I had my kids take a picture of the two of us, just a little smiling little picture, and I'll forward that to you, Chuck, and the rest of the board members if you're interested.
Thank you.
She was grateful.
Good.
What happened with the person who won the time at Matera?
Same person.
Same person.
Chris.
Oh, the same
Chris.
Person won?
Yeah.
We had a fantastic.
Stuffed the box?
No.
Did
so
you ask her?
Huh? If she stuffed the box, I didn't ask her. I should have. No. So we gave people at the Friends and Family Day the option to write either that if they wanted just the shrub and not time at Matera, that they could write on the tag shrub or Matera or. And if they didn't write anything, it was both. So I made copies and had two sets of names, and it was just the luck of the draw at the last meeting. So
very lucky.
That sounds great.
Yeah.
2 hours at Matera.
2 hours at Matera.
Can't go wrong.
Maybe we'll do that sometime soon.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
We should have some meetings over there.
We need to have some kind of a policy meeting at Matera.
We can't even get a
policy.
I'll write that for you.
Yeah.
We'll have Chuck edit it.
Poor Harry's scorned. He's scorned. He's been rebuffed.
Any other comments or issues to be brought up tonight?
We got a Tennessee Gas vegetation control.
Right.
Document.
Any comments? I mean, it's kind of come through a few times. These
we keep on seeing this.
Yearly operational plans. Well, we have a lot of stuff running through Reading.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. We have the train tracks, we have the gas line, we have the power
lines. Do we
lines.
Have a copy of the vegetation management plan on file?
I could ask them to send me a copy.
Why don't we do that?
Isn't that
electronic or paper?
Paper. No, electronic.
You know, they say they're coming in to do vegetation maintenance activity through Reading, and they're saying, you know, the next sentence is kind of funny. It says work is expected to take place from August 2016 through March 2017.
Right.
So there's an exact date for you about when they're going to be coming through town. You know, now is this the same company that came to us and showed us the photo?
No.
Okay. All right. Gotcha. The other one was MBTA commuter line.
I could contact them and say, come here and talk to us about what you're doing.
I would like to see
that. I can imagine the response.
It sent somebody.
Well, they also said, do we disagree with the fact that they said, we're informing you, but we actually are not required to come before you?
Right.
I think they all love doing that.
I'm pretty sure the consultant would jump at the chance to go to a meeting.
Yeah.
And
bill it out.
Bill it
a couple more hours.
They usually ask, are there any good restaurants around, and I'm
not coming
well,
from
down from Maine or
well,
something.
Well, not only that, but the gas pipeline goes really, if I'm not wrong, it goes really near a vernal pool on Stroud Ave.
Okay, this goes right through the one at
right
at the entrance to the compost center.
Yeah.
Right. So, I mean, I think we do have an interest to.
Well, they said they'd walk through there and cut by hand.
The vernal pool area?
And anywhere that was wet.
Rotary mowers. Where was the cutting by hand? Tractor mounted aerial buckets, ground crews with chainsaws, side trimming at edge of right of way. Where was the.
I don't remember, I read it on my phone. I didn't have a hard copy.
Mr. Chuck, will this help you at all?
In areas too saturated to support wheeled tractors, handheld brush trimmers are utilized.
I guess what I'm saying is, you know, time of year matters for the vernal pool area.
I get a goal now.
So
you wouldn't
right
want them stomping
it's
around
it's
in March.
No, it's more like
it's
April.
Fall. Yeah.
It'd be really good if they did it during a nice dry spell in the winter, if they could. But
August,
when everything's
August
good
to March.
Yeah, that'll help.
So
where's your checklist? What were those things you had to go across for the electronic?
Okay. Any other issues, comments?
Okay.
And welcome aboard, Dave. Nice to have you aboard. And do I hear a motion to adjourn the meeting?
Second.
Okay.
All right.
Thank you, everyone.
Can you read it and then just